Welcome to another edition of our Ramily Hangout series. Emmanuel Berbari with Fordham Interim Director of Athletics at Kull. We have a special guest today, former Fordham football head coach, Patriot League champion, offensive coordinator at Oregon, fresh off a Pac-12 championship, and we are grateful to have you here today. Joe Moorhead. Joe, thanks so much for being here.
Really appreciate it, fellas. Hope you guys are doing well. Thanks for having me on.
Joe, hours removed from the Pac-12 championship. Amazing, obviously, how 2020 has played out here. Coach, you and I have talked a lot in my initial 9 months on the job, and we had a conversation probably in September, maybe late August, early September. Pac-12 wasn't even playing football yet or even talking about playing football yet. And you were telling me about how Oregon and how youth sports were shut down there, and Little Moorhead, who I know is a baseball player, which is near and dear to me too, wasn't even playing ball. And you were asking me about Patriot League and Atlantic 10 and what we're doing in New York City. Can you imagine being here on December 19th, Pac-12 champions? You need another ring on another of those fingers, and you're running out of fingers soon for championship rings. And the world's an interesting place. I know you're a very faithful man. You're a good Fordham man. Manny left out. He's a Hall of Famer for us, as well as obviously former football player and quarterback for the Rams. And you know your Ramily has been following you this whole way through. No football for us this semester, so you become our adopted team, and you're our adopted son, as you know, our favorite son. Tell us how does this work out? And I know you had a plan. You always do, but you couldn't have drew this up any better, Coach.
No, I mean, 2020 in a lot of different ways has been such a roller coaster of events, not just football, but in our country and around the world. And, you know, as you mentioned earlier, it's gone from, you know, not having a season to deciding we're going to play, you know, going through a truncated schedule, having the opportunity to play Washington in the season finale to determine who was the Pac North champion, and to see who, went to the Pac-12 championship game. And then Washington was hit with some COVIDs, and they weren't able to play. So we jumped in there, and we actually game planned three different opponents in the span of 10 days. So we were putting a game plan together for Washington. That game got canceled. Then Washington became the Pac-12 North representative. So we were set to play Colorado, and then Washington found out they couldn't play. So we had to step in. And obviously USC's a phenomenal, team and opponent, but just to culminate this football season with a championship after all that this team the kids have been through. It was of the championship teams I've been a part of, this was a particularly rewarding experience on a lot of different levels just because of the challenges everybody's faced.
Coach, as you were outlining, no real playbook for a season like this. Was there any motto that you or the team went by to stay on focus and stay in line towards the championship?
Yeah, Coach Chris Ball, our head coach, has done a phenomenal job just relative to our culture and our process. And he always talks about going 1-0 every week. And that didn't just pertain to the things that we were doing, relative to our preparation and our play on the field. But, he was very, specific about our protocols and our players staying safe and making sure they're wearing their mask and socially distancing and doing all those things. And I think our players did a really good job with that. So we're a very process-oriented organization, but I think that showed up on a lot of different levels, not just on the field, but off the field as well.
Coach, you also were talking about the thrill of winning a championship. You were a 2014 Patriot League champion at Fordham, of course, as well. When you look back at that season and your time at Fordham, what was most rewarding about being able to get that done?
That particular game, I mean, we had a lot of great players on that team. You know, it was an excellent season. And it came down to that finale at Bucknell. And I don't know, you probably recall, midweek, Michael Niebrick, our starting quarterback, was ruled out of the game with appendicitis. So we had to go with Peter Metzold, our backup quarterback. We fell behind in the second half, made a late run. I think Chase Edmonds scored a touchdown to tie the thing up and send it into overtime. And then we had a great double move called to Bucky Jones. It caught them on a slant corner, and Tabucky caught it and tried to punt the ball and about half missed it, and everyone went nuts. But that's the thing I remember the most. It was a really special team, a lot of great kids. Beat a lot of really good teams, including some 1A teams. And, I think there was also a barbecue fire at halftime of that game as well. I think that stopped the game, if I'm not mistaken. One of their – one of their food vendors caught fire and stopped the game midway through. So that's another thing that sticks out from that game. That was pretty funny as well.
Coach, that's an incredible memory and detail that you have of those. And we actually have some good news on Mike Niebrick, by the way. He just got voted into the Fordham Rams Hall of Fame.
Oh, he did?
He did, Coach.
Oh, that's awesome. He texted me last night. I have to hit him up.
Please do. He'll be happy to hear that you're aware of that. And, Coach, throughout this odd year, and obviously Manny talks about the incredible run at Fordham, but throughout this odd year, you know, your offense was on top of number one for many weeks. You were offensive coordinator multiple weeks throughout this year, throughout this weird season. You literally are our first year coordinator back with Oregon, new system, new relationships, new part of the country, new head coach. I mean, talk about how you're able to just find success quickly, adapt, and really implement your style, your approach, and your culture and environment quickly to a program. And here we are again, Pac-12 champions. Amazing.
Yeah, I think the biggest challenge was, you know, coming off of essentially no spring ball. So we were four practices in when the thing really hit and they shut it down. And then everything turned into a Zoom world. We were trying to, you know, teach your concepts and install your offense, you know, virtually. And, you know, that works well, but only to a certain extent. And then, you know, you weren't playing the season. You kind of had a shortened up, you know, fall camp. But for us to have, you know, Justin Herbert obviously graduated and is on his way to being Rookie of the Year. Panay Sewell, you know, opted out for the season, you know, our Outland Trophy winner. So we had a new quarterback, five new starting offensive linemen, a bunch of new faces. So for our kids to be able to, you know, lead the league in total offense, scored over 30 a game in every game but one, I think, this year, and then, you know, end it with a pretty solid performance against a great USC team in the championship. You know, I think it speaks volumes to our culture and to our players.
Coach, flashing back to some of the points we were hitting on about your time at Fordham, you mentioned Chase Edmonds, and I'm curious from your perspective, you coached him the early stages of his Fordham career, and he kind of shattered every expectation. Now, to the extent where he's a really productive National Football League player, has this surprised you at all, what you've seen from Chase, knowing his character, coaching him along the way?
I can't really say it has surprised me. You know, there's sometimes where a guy maybe at an FCS level, you know, that's kind of always the underdog story. But Chase came in with a chip on his shoulder, you know, very lightly recruited. I think we did a great job with the identification and the evaluation. And then when he came here, I'll say the rest kind of took care of itself. I remember it was one of our first fall camp scrimmages of his true freshman year, and we called a run play when he was in with the twos, and he broke an 80-yard touchdown run, and all the coaches kind of just turned and looked at each other like, hey, man, we might have something special here. And really didn't start the first game against St. Francis, but I think he went for close to 200 yards of total offense. And, you know, for as talented of a player as Chase Edmonds is, they'll kill me in English. Just added a sentence and a preposition there. My English major is going to get revoked here. But he's just as good of a – I mean, his character, his work ethic, you know, all those things, when you combine talent and work ethic and character, to me, it can't be a surprise what he's doing. And, you know, certainly very proud of Chase and, you know, everything he's doing at the next level.
Coach, I know you get a bunch of text messages from Fordham faithful, your former classmates, your former teammates, student athlete that's played for you. If you could give a little message here to your Fordham family, your Fordham Ramily out there that, you know, has probably sent you a bunch of text messages. I'm sure you haven't even been able to get through them all. But as they congratulate you on winning another conference championship and the fifth conference championship, a different conference that you've been a part of, just remarkable. Give a little Fordham love and a little Bronx cheer to some of those folks that I'm sure excited to hear from you.
No, absolutely. And first and foremost, you got to be excited about Coach Collin and the direction he's taking the program. Joe was a defensive lineman at Pitt when I was a first year GA. So, and his mom actually taught my wife in high school. So I know Joe's doing a great job there with the staff and some of the upgrades that have taking place with the facilities and giving the kids an opportunity to really, you know, hone in and be successful. But yeah, I mean, they talk about Fordham being a family, and it's really not cliche. You know, you come out of off the field and you're checking your text messages and, you know, seeing things online through social media, and it's classmates, it's teammates, it's kids you coached, it's their parents, it's administrators that, you know, that bond that you make as a student athlete or part of the Fordham community is one that is cannot be understated, and it is always something that sticks with you. So certainly for my 4 years there as a player, my 4 years there as a coach. There are bonds and ties there that can never be broken. And, you know, it's just, it's something that's unique and special. And the whole, you know, when you package it together with a Jesuit mindset and mentality, you know, I think that's something that's kind of separates Fordham from other places.
Coach, very well said. Congratulations again. And we really appreciate a couple of minutes here.
Awesome, guys. Really appreciate your time. Keep up the great work and go Rams.
Coach, thank you so much from myself, Coach Conlin, Father McShane. And hopefully it is Fiesta Bowl. I know we'll figure out where it lands, and be excited to watch you and continue to support you. Good luck to you and best to your family, please.
Appreciate it. Thanks, Ed.